The New South Wales Nationals are on a very different page to you when it comes to emissions reduction. They're backing the halving of emissions by 2030 in New South Wales. Why such a different view from them to you?
Well, you have to. I can only answer half that question, Kieran. I can answer for my viewpoints, and always happy to do so. I can't explain the views of others.
My principal concern
is that this policy. For sure, for sure. But I'm not a spokesperson for other people, whether in my party or otherwise. But from my perspective, net zero emissions is a bad idea because it would cost thousands of jobs in this country and not do anything to protect the environment. Fundamentally, that's the main problem with it. Apart from that, Kieran, it's fantastic policy. I mean, as we see today in figures released
what about
by the
jobs
Public
created,
Affairs, hundreds.
What about the jobs created in those industries that Matt Keane describes as the biggest economic opportunity of a lifetime? Do you not recognise those jobs, new industries?
We've been promised that for years and it hasn't eventuated. We're promised all these jobs in renewables and they just become sugar hits. When the turbines are going up, when the solar panels are being installed, sure, there are some jobs. But as soon as those projects go into their operational phase, there's no one there. You should come out, hopefully, on their tour around regional New South Wales. They'll go and inspect some wind turbines and solar farms because it's very hard
lithium?
To spot a human being.
Critical minerals.
Well, again,
still
here,
stuff
again,
up from
lithium.
The ground.
Yep. Sure. And I'm a big supporter of the lithium industry, big supporter of developing more in the battery supply chain and put a lot of money, set up a cooperative research centre when I was resources minister to
help take advantages
in battery minerals. But there's 2 points to make here, Kieran. Number one, in terms of size, let's get real here, lithium exports are approaching about $3 billion worth of value currently. Our coal industry exports about $50 billion and LNG another $50 billion on top of that. So we're well away from anywhere close to that. The other point here is
but the trajectory
we should have a growth plan.
But it's the right trajectory, isn't it? Because you're talking about 70% of lithium in Tesla batteries comes from Australia, electric cars growing. The Treasurer, your colleague Josh Frydenberg, says it's like the iPhone. Everyone's going to have it soon. And
sure.
Don't we need
and
to
why shouldn't
see
we
that
grow
trajectory?
All industries? I mean, I was about to say, Kieran, the real issue I have with this argument is somehow we can only have a certain number of jobs in regional Australia and we've got to lose some jobs to gain others. We don't have to do that. We actually can grow all of these industries. There's nothing inconsistent with saying let's grow the lithium industry and I'm all for electric cars. It's great. They're coal-fired power cars, right? I mean, people charge them at night. They're certainly not charging them from solar power. So great. That's great. That's going to be a growing industry for Australia. And as you can see right now around the world, the demand for Australian coal and gas has never been higher. So let's take those opportunities as well and grow those opportunities too because we've got so much we could do here in regional Australia if we're just unleashed
to
do what we can do best in the world.
So the prices now are high. You're saying, so let's grow it. But that don't you miss a key point with 70% of our major export recipients committing to net zero? So while the demand is there now, aren't we missing the planning for the future if we adopt your approach? Because those countries,
well, number one, I don't think have committed
to net zero. Number one,
I don't think those countries are going to meet net zero targets. You know, if you believe the Chinese Communist Party's expressions and statements, good luck. But
what about Japan, Korea, I wouldn't be betting my home on it.
The other point to make here is that even if countries do reduce their emissions, we have the world's best quality coal and gas resources. There will continue to be strong demand for Australian resources because of that. So we're in terms of coal, we're only 5% of the world coal market. We're actually not that big a deal in terms of coal production. If you ask many people in Australia, I think they get that wrong. It's quite a myth about that. And so all we need to do, even if coal demand was to, say, halve, and I don't think that'll happen anytime soon, but even if it was to halve, all we need to do is increase our market share from 5 to 10%, which we could easily do given the high-quality nature of our resources, and we'd still be exporting exactly the same. In fact, I think
Are you worried about the argument that Josh Frydenberg made, again, your federal colleague, who talks about the fact that capital markets have made their decision, that they factor in climate profile, climate risk profiles, and that we would pay a lot more for dollars.
Okay, so on that point, on the point of having to pay more for interest rates, well, Kieran, I think any bank, any international financier who expects to be able to say who they can finance here in this country, and they can say no to legal activities, should not be welcome in this country. How is that any different from the Chinese Communist Party telling us that we should write certain things or laws and if we want to trade with them? What these international banks are saying, is if you don't have a net zero emissions target, we're not going to lend to you. Well, we should tell them to bugger off because we're an independent sovereign country. And if that means we pay
more,
and I don't think we will, but even if it was to mean we pay... Well, Kieran, I think the independent nature of our country, our sovereign right to determine our own laws, is a little bit more important than a few basis points on interest rates, even if they affect our mortgage rates.
But doesn't that then start to hit your economic argument?
Previous generation...
It starts to hit your economic argument, though.
Well, absolutely, but some things are worth paying for, Kieran. I mean, previous generations of Australians sacrificed their lives to defend our independence. And if we're asked to just pay a little bit more on our mortgage, I think we should probably do that. And we are doing that with China. With China, we have told them to bugger off.
Okay, yeah, but
with China, we have said...
It's counterintuitive. You're saying that it's making money, high prices, you know, demanding high prices and that sort of stuff, but then we've got to fork out more on interest rates to prop up the industry.
No, I didn't. Actually, I didn't say that, Kieran. I don't think that's going to be the case. What I'm saying is I was accepting the premise. If interest rates were to go up because of this, I'd still think that would be a price worth paying to protect your independence and sovereignty. Now, a separate question is, will they go up if we do this? I don't see any evidence for that at all. There's no shortage of capital in Australia. There's no shortage of capital in the world. Yes, there are some financiers who are making these points, some big, big investment banks like BlackRock, but I don't know why we'd let BlackRock and the elite of Wall Street and the city in London decide what we do here in this country. Oh, that's an absurd
argument.
Is
there any
decide. Now, I'm all for if the...
Is there any deal... Let me just finish because we're almost out of time, but I want to ask you, is there any deal that the Prime Minister could do with Barnaby Joyce? Yeah, no, I enjoy it too, but my producer, we're being told we've got to move on, but Barnaby Joyce is a good friend of yours, as we all know. You're very close to Barnaby Joyce. If he does a deal with the Prime Minister that gets the country to net zero, which has basically, you know, like New South Wales has done, they're not making any change in policy. They've set that target. They think they're going to get there anyway. Is there any arrangement in which Barnaby Joyce agrees to that with the Prime Minister where you'll get on board?
No, Kieran, I've said time and time again, I'm not for sale. I think the right thing for our country right now is to focus on rebuilding our manufacturing industries and getting ourselves stronger, especially given we've been told in the last few weeks that there's a great risk of conflict with China. It's not me saying that. That is the reason we bought the nuclear subs. And so if that is the biggest, if that's the issue we face, why are we spending so much time focused on this net zero stuff? It just doesn't make any sense. So that's my position. I will continue to fight for that. There's a lot of people who support me. And I'll continue to be their voice. If others do different things, like as I said earlier, I can't control that. That's good luck to them. But it's a free country. I don't think we should be afraid of different views in our nation's parliament. No, and I'll keep being that point of difference if I have to be.
It is a free country, and we appreciate chatting. Thanks, Matt Canavan.
Still, Canavan. At least for now.